Penguin Random House Audio presents The Moonshine Shack Murder by Diane Kelly. Read for you by Tyla Collier. To Carol Helm Pickett, my moonshine drinking buddy and a lady who always shines bright. Bottoms up. Chapter 1. The machinery sloshed, whirred, jangled, and clinked as I stood in breathless anticipation at the end of the conveyor belt on the factory floor. Where is it? Come on! After another jangle and clink, the rubber safety strips that hung over the machine's exit hatch swung outward, and there it was. The first jar of my Firefly brand moonshine, the mason jar's aluminum lid sparkling in the light from the fixtures overhead. Woohoo! I threw my fists in the air and snatched the jar from the belt, planting a big kiss on the label before hugging it to my chest. Melodramatic, maybe, but this jar had been years in the making. I'd invested my heart, soul, blood, sweat, and tears into my new moonshine business, not to mention every last cent I'd saved, and then some. The first payment on my bank loan would be due in 2 short weeks. Good thing my moonshine shack would be ready to open for business first thing Monday morning, only 3 days from now. I slipped the inaugural jar of shine in my tote bag and readied a cardboard box. Another jar exited the hatch and began its journey down the metal rollers, shimmying like one of Beyoncé's backup dancers. I grabbed the jar and tucked it into a corner of the box, adding 11 more as they jiggled their way toward me over the next 2 minutes. The ancient bottling machine wasn't fast, but it was efficient enough for my small batch operation, and the factory manager had charged me a fair price to use it. A quick zip-zip with the strapping tape dispenser, and the box was sealed and ready to be loaded into my secondhand cargo van for transport to my shop. I'd had the van painted day glow green and affixed magnetic signs with my Firefly Moonshine logo to both sides. Might as well advertise my wares while I drive around town, right? My good friend Kiki, a freelance artist, had designed the whimsical logo for me. The graphic featured 2 flirty cartoon fireflies writing in fluorescent green against a midnight blue background. The first firefly used his bright behind to spell Firefly. The other used her dazzling derriere to spell moonshine. The image was cute and eye-catching, perfect for my products. The floor supervisor circled around to check on things.
Everything all right over here, Miss Hayes?
My dark curls bobbed as I turned to him.
Looking good?
I pointed to the carton at my feet. My first case. Isn't it marvelous? He chuckled.
Never seen anyone get so excited about their products.
I shrugged.
What can I say? Moonshine's in my blood.
It was true, figuratively and sometimes literally. Back in the days of Prohibition, my great-granddaddy was the #1 bootlegger in the region, the primary supplier of hooch all the way from his hometown of Chattanooga, Tennessee, south to the Chattahoochee River in Georgia. He'd made a small fortune before the sheriff arrested him. While my great-grandfather lost the fortune to revenuers, homestead laws allowed him to hang on to his rustic cabin in the Smoky Mountains and the rusty still hidden among the pine trees at the back of his property. He'd passed the cabin, the still, and the secrets of making moonshine along to my granddaddy, who'd passed them down to me when he'd moved to the Singing River retirement home a few years ago. Yep. Making moonshine was a family tradition, and it was high time the Hayes family started making money at it again. With money-making in mind, I drove my van to the moonshine shack late Friday afternoon. The place was adorable, if I do say so myself. I'd hired a carpenter to create a front facade that resembled a hillbilly house. He'd fashioned an awning of spare boards that appeared haphazardly nailed together for effect, but was completely up to code and had easily passed inspection. The words Moonshine Shack were spelled out in neon green glow-in-the-dark letters over the awning. I'd situated a couple of wooden rockers and a porch swing out front to entice tourists to sit a spell. Shamelessly stealing an idea from the Cracker Barrel restaurants, I'd also set out a small table and two stools so customers could challenge each other to a game of checkers, chess, or cards. I wanted the Shine Shack to be a comfortable, inviting place with a casual country charm. But even more, I wanted it to be a smashing success. I'd left a secure job with the Chattanooga Bakery, Inc., maker of the world-famous moon pie, and sacrificed a regular paycheck and the promise of a pension. I'd hate for it to have been for naught. I circled around to the alley, parked, and hopped out to unlock the back door that led to the storeroom. My gray cat, Smokey, named for the nearby mountains, lay atop the wooden desk in the corner, watching me with his firefly green eyes as he lazily licked a paw. The cat weighed upward of 16 pounds and, unless food was in the offing, rarely moved, more cinder block than companion. I greeted him, as always, with an affectionate scratch under the chin and a, "Hey boy, did you miss me?" His yawn told me that my absence had not affected him in the least. Hurtful, sure, but I'd long since accepted that ours would be a one-sided relationship. Even with help from a dolly, moving the cases from the van to the storeroom proved to be back-breaking work. The muscles in my arms strained and shook, unused to being punished so severely. Smokey cast me a look of disdain each time I groaned or grunted. Next batch, I'd box the moonshine in smaller cases of 6 jars rather than 12. As I rolled the dolly outside to round up more moonshine, my ears picked up an unexpected sound. Clop, clop, clop. I turned to discover a mounted police officer riding up the alleyway on a beautiful chestnut mare. The horse's reddish-brown coat gleamed in the sunshine as she tossed her flaxen mane. The officer wore his uniform with black riding boots, a helmet, and mirrored sunglasses. Despite being built like a sculpted boulder, he rode with a graceful athleticism, at one with his steed. Clop, clop. When they reached me, the officer pulled back on the reins and spoke to his horse.
"Whoa, Charlotte. Let's find out what this little filly is up to."
It took me a moment to realize I was the little filly he spoke of. Standing a mere 5 feet, I was undeniably small, but I made up for my stature and tenacity and sass. I looked up at the officer to see a set of broad shoulders, a strong jaw, and myself looking back reflected in his sunglasses. I angled my head to indicate his horse. "I see you've got a thing for leggy blondes." He sat silent and unmoving for a few beats before his lips spread in a slow smile. He ducked his chin and reached up to ease his sunglasses down, gazing at me over the rims. His amber eyes lit up like lightning bugs in amusement. His focus shifted to the logo on my van and the cartons of liquor before returning to my face.
"A bootlegger, huh? I suspect you'll cause me no end of trouble."
"I can't make any promises, officer." In a swift, smooth move, he slid down from his horse to stand directly in front of me. He towered over me by a foot and then some, putting him around 6 feet 2 inches tall and putting me on eye level with his rock-hard pecs and his name badge, M. Landers. Why does that name sound vaguely familiar? Officer Landers removed his glasses and tucked them into the collar of his uniform.
"I'll give you a hand. Charlotte needs a rest anyway."
With my back and biceps screaming for mercy, I wasn't about to turn him down.
"Thanks."
He tied his horse's reins to a water pipe before reaching up to remove his helmet. When he did, he released a cascade of loose, short curls the color of buckskin. He ran his hand through his hair, and it settled into a contemporary pompadour, short on the sides, longer on top. He resembled a rockabilly artist, or a blonde version of Elvis from his early years. I felt the heat of a blush warm my cheeks. He grabbed a case from the back of the van and tucked it under one arm before grabbing another. As he turned to carry them through the back door of my shop, he spotted Smokey standing sentinel in the doorway.
Is your guard cat going to attack?
Smokey? I stepped over and scooped my precious pet up in my arms. He's harmless. Smokey stiff-armed me, pushing his paw against my chest, playing hard to get.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.